Meeting will come to order at 6:03 PM. Ms. Burgos, will you please take roll call?
Trustees present tonight are Calderon, Aguilar, and Vizcarra, with Trustee Duarte and Trustee Kim absent. You have a quorum.
Mr. Cooper, will you please lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I was going to start singing.
Board members, I'd like for us to take note of the fact that we need to, before we call for a motion to approve the agenda, I'd like to modify H1 to reflect approved certificated / classified employment report for January 28, 2013. Do I have a motion to approve the agenda as stipulated?
So we're just going to change it from, we're just going to change the title, basically, is that
we're,
what you're saying?
Yeah, we're adding classified because we do have a classified item on the last page.
Yes.
You'll see coaching and other assignments.
Yes, okay.
So if we're going to discuss it in closed session, we need to add it.
I move to approve.
Motion by Calderon, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Vizcarra. Turno Vizcarra. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously, 3-0. Comments from public, closed session items only. Mr. Chad Cooper, ACT President.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm concerned about the ACES Assets Director position. It appears that you're trying to take two ACT represented positions, combine them into one management position. That's a loss of two full-time equivalents in my bargaining unit. And I've never seen backup documents that show why, what new duties there are that's making this from a certificated job to a management job. I believe it may have been improper how you approved this before. It was an unagendized item that came out of closed session to combine them. I believe the combining of two positions is a public session item, not a closed session item. Closed session might deal with who's going to staff that position once you've made that combination. But I've contacted CTA, and they're standing with me on this, that we don't just stand by and watch two FTEs out of our bargaining unit go away without a public explanation on what the job duties are. So if this is the intent of the district to do this, I'd appreciate it if you guys did it the right way. Right now, I don't even have a job description of what this person's going to do that makes it a management rather than a ACT certificated position. So I just wanted to give you that heads up. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cooper. Mrs. Zambriz? In regards to closed session?
Are we ready?
Yep. You need to read the... Mm-hmm.
We're going into closed session, right?
You need to read it out.
Okay. For closed session, we have the public employment, employee appointments and employments under Government Code Section 54957, which are all positions included in certificated and classified employment reports, in addition to public employee discipline, dismissal, release, resignation, Government Code Section 54957. Okay. That would be all we have.
Thank you. We will now go into closed session at 6:05. We will now reconvene from closed session at 7:12. Ms. Ambriz?
Yes. There are no reportable items that were taken into closed session. Taken in closed session?
No, not the assignments?
Well, we're going to vote him.
Oh, that's right. I'm sorry.
Going to vote him out here?
Thank you. Comments from the public? I don't have anything. Has anybody submitted? Only thing I had was from Mr. Cooper at closed session. Okay, seeing none, we will move on to H1. Approved certificated / classified employment report for January 28, 2013. Is there a motion? Yes.
Ms. Ambriz, were you going to talk about something?
With regards to the ACES Assets District Coordinator? Yes. Prior to going into closed session, there was a public comment regarding the coordinator position as to it not being administrative, that it's a teacher position, certificated assignment. And I'm not going to provide the full history of it. I'm going to have Dr. Estrada come up and provide the rationale for the position as it's requested. But prior to a few years ago, initially, when ACES was initially instated in our district, it was an administrative position at one time. And there were at least two, maybe three different people who held the position of ACES district coordinator as an administrator. Somewhere down the line, and I'm not sure the history at that point, it did go into the certificated realm, but it was initially an administrative position. I'll have Dr. Estrada come up and just kind of give you a brief rationale as to why we sustain that this should continue to be or return into an administrative position.
So you don't have a job description?
It's going to be put up right there.
Okay, I'm Isaac Estrada, Director of Academic Services, and I'm responsible for the ACES Assets Program at the district level. One of the main reasons why it is proposed that this position, the ACES District Coordinator, it becomes a management position or an administrator position, is the significant amount of responsibilities in supervising staff. More specifically, this position requires the oversight of approximately 7 schools, first through eighth, but also the high school. And part of the responsibilities is, number one, recruiting highly qualified individuals, for example, academic supervisors. Number two is actually providing support and direction as needed to site ACES coordinators, and those are the certificated staff. So in this position, sometimes it requires that there's due process involved when hiring staff, but also dismissing staff. And of course, the nature of the job is most likely that there's some dismissals throughout the year. So we definitely need an administrator to take care of those responsibilities that involve due process and the discipline process. And we need the supervisor with that specific skill set. Number two is on the fiscal situation or financial reasons. Number one is assets is about, ACES is about $1 million budget, approximately. Assets is about $250,000. This requires a significant amount of attention to detail and ability to monitor budgets so we can be in compliance. ACES and assets are actually oversight also from the California Department of Ed, and as such, we have specific policies or procedures to follow. And we need somebody with the technical expertise to follow, make sure that those are actually implemented at the site level. And that's why we need somebody with the ability to provide training, provide direction to site coordinators, again, to academic supervisors. Overall, I think our number of academic supervisors is about 40 And in addition, about 16 site ACES coordinators. So that's a significant amount of responsibility in terms of staffing. And again, another reason which is important to have this management position is because of the challenge that we have every day. I mean, every year, when at the beginning of the year, we need somebody there consistently. And the challenge has been that whenever it's been a certificated position or teaching position, we have a turnaround in that position. And we definitely need somebody there consistent to take care of the recruitment at the beginning of the year so we have all of our schools fully staffed and supported.
I have a question, Dr. Estrada. Did you contact school services in terms of this strategic move?
Yes, I did contact both the ACES and the ACES state-level directors, and I specifically mentioned to them what I was proposing, and on the two levels, on the one, the fiscal matters, and number two, on the staffing, and they said that they would they approve it because it is within compliance. So hopefully that would answer your question. So yes. Okay. So they're supportive.
Members, do you have additional questions for Dr. Estrada?
No.
No, I just have the same question that you had.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Estrada.
Thank you.
Right. Are there any other questions regarding anything else on the certificated classified employment report?
You would probably also need to name your TBA under.
Please proceed.
The person that we are recommending to the board to serve as an interim coordinator of FRC and student services is Ms. Betty Nunez Lim, currently an AST at Calexico High School.
Okay. No further questions? Okay. I'll entertain a motion to approve.
I will second that.
No. Will you motion by Zuno Vizcarra, second by Calderon. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes unanimously 3-0. Item I, discussion items. One, create a district committee of people with known expertise in the area of parent involvement. Two, have the committee establish two areas of focus for improving parent involvement. A first focus, providing parents with strategies to help them with at-risk children, and B, second focus, offering parents a variety of academic trainings. I place this item on a request for this item to be placed on the agenda for a purpose of discussion to sharing information with the board. It is not an action item. It is informational only. I do have some backup information that I did provide to the district, but I don't know if it was attached to online. In any case, just to share with the public present, in years past when I worked with this district, we had a very successful parent training program out at William Moreno Junior High. And I asked Mr. Padilla Sr. if he would share his knowledge and his experience in how that program was run. So, Mr. Padilla, could you speak to it, please?
First of all, thank you for inviting me, and I have having the opportunity to share with you some of the experiences that I had with the parent project. When I was working at William Moreno, when I began as a teacher, I began with a parent project. I was invited by Emily Palacio to go and get training in Ontario. There has been many people, I want to say dozens of people that have been trained, but there have been very few that really advocated for the program, so most of those people just went for the training and never really put any effort into it. There was a few of us in William Moreno that thought that parenting was probably one of the most important things that we should have in our school. Informed, trained parent is the best ally that a school district can have. but it has to be structured in a way that it's beneficial. So in Willie Moreno, there was always a debate between academics and parenting. And of course, you know, academics has always been very, very strong support in parenting, not that much. But when we look back at history, we saw that Willie Moreno was very, very successful. It was probably the most successful school in terms of the way we want to like to measure in our district with CST scores. And Willie Moreno was always very successful with CST scores. There was one time when we had that debate within the staff, and our principal at that time, Mr. Dorwood, for some reason was convinced to drop the parenting. And, you know, believe it or not, that year that we didn't have the strong parenting component, CST scores just dropped. So we review and we talked about it again. So we brought the parent project back, and then our CST scores again began to improve. And it was something that we structured at Willie Moreno. We didn't go with the plan that the district had, the district level had. Sometimes the district tried to impose on us, but Mr. Dorwood always defended the method that we were using. So we kept our own method and tried to be in compliance with the four mandatory hours, but in addition we put other parent components like an orientation in the beginning of the year, some strategies with eighth graders, ninth graders, and then each department had their own parenting component to inform the parents about it, to the point where Mr. Dorwood thought that we were being very successful with parenting and also with character education. And he decided to petition a grant, and we wanted to see how powerful this component could be if we put it into place in a very structured way. And I'm not going to go into details because it will take a lot of time, but he petitioned this grant, and we chose 50 seventh graders that would be around the 300 level in CST scores, which was, basic, in the basic level. So we were around 295, 303, and things like that. And they took the traditional teaching, there was no changes in that. We added a character ed component, which was one class where they received character ed and extra supervision on their performance. And then we added the parent project, which was about an 8-week mandatory training for parents, and then some training that was follow-up. I didn't bring the proof, the papers, but the improvement in our students in their CST scores was just dramatic. We had some students improving up to 100 points from one year to the other. The students themselves said, you know, it was because there was this change in my attitude because of what was being taught in the classroom, in the character education class, and because of my parents' consistency of having me do the best that I could do in school. And so the parenting for me has always been a very powerful weapon. I have been very successful with my students because I have this relationship with parents, and the training that we provide them helps them deal with a lot of the problems that we see in our schools. You know, like last year, there was a lot of comments about attendance, for example. You know, attendance is very important, but how do we deal with it? I mean, we just talk about attendance and we just say things about attendance, but we don't really do something about it. And where should we work? We should work with the parents. You know, the parents, if we do some structure, some well-implemented parenting, we can teach them about all of these things. There are several people that are still very interested. We were never invited or allowed to structure the program that existed before. So I know that the program was not seen as something very very powerful, convenient, because the way it was seen at the district level, it just seemed like it was something that was just there. But if you analyze how we did it at Willie Moreno, you could see that it was a very powerful component, and it was always part of the success in the CST scores. You know, there's a lot of problems that can be addressed. There's a lot of people that still want to be part of structuring and delivering the instruction. You know, to mention a few, or one person that is very advocate about it is Rosa Lopez, and at Willie Moreno we had a few people. They're not in Willie Moreno now, but they're still within the district, and I'm pretty sure that they would be very glad to be part of it. You know, our parents. You know, I'll ask a question right now. You know, raise your hand if you're a parent. Yeah. Where did you go to school? Yeah, where did you went to school? Yeah, where did you go to school? To become a parent? No. Parents don't go to school to become parents. And the way society is today, it's a big challenge for our parents. And if we don't have people to help our parents deal with the problems in the family and deal the problems with schools and academics, then, you know, we really are fighting against something very difficult. If we have parent training that would help the parents, and in terms the parents help their kids, and in terms all these trainings will help our district, our schools to become better in academic achievement and social skills, you know, we would be able to stop a lot of the attendance problems, you know, bullying problems in the schools.
Mr. Padilla, you know, could you briefly share what that meeting that you invited me to, where I observed and also participated, when you spoke to?
One of the phenomenons in our city, and this is something that, you know, I kind of like feel sad that it happens, is that our parents are not very political and they're not very adamant about coming to meetings or anything like that. But I did a parenting, I volunteered to do a parenting session because we wanted to introduce the bullying and you know, develop this safe environment for the TEARS program in Jefferson School, which has been a very successful program. In the last 3 weeks, we had a lot of success. And another time I'll come and give a report on that. But I thought that parents needed to come in, and so we did a big campaign to bring parents. We were not very successful in bringing in parents, you know, for different reasons. But the parents that we did have, we tried to deliver some very key important concepts. One of them was relationship between parents and kids. When you have a good relationship with your kids, you become a very strong influence on them. So if the parent is having a good influence on their kids, and the parent is focused that influence into becoming better academic achievers, then the kids are going to improve. Also, we know that the kids are going from child to adolescence, and in that stage of development, there's always big conflicts. There's a lot of family conflict, and we taught the parents how to, or at least we introduced the parents how to deal with a conflict, how to avoid having this you know, fights in the family, and then also we help them to develop better habits in terms of academics or social or just the family unit. The parents were very, very happy that they heard. Their comments were, why don't we have this? Why don't we continue with this? And, you know, my answer was, well, you know, we could if we had this parent project bringing back and we structure it the correct way. Parents, a lot of them say, oh, we need to go. We're going to go to the board meeting and we're going to go and tell the board members, and, you know. And what happened was that just one person came and the person got very nervous, and in the last meeting she just stood up and said, we won a parent project in Jefferson, and that's all she could say because she was so nervous. Well, that's the dynamics of our parents. Our parents are not people that are going to come here and be political and be persistent and be this, but the need that they have, I mean, I would invite you, if you would put me a group of parents, I would volunteer to give you a two-hour presentation, and I would invite anyone who wants to come and see it, and I would like for you to see the faces of those parents, how they take these parenting classes, and how they get very excited about it. But this is just one shot, you know. We need to give them more shots throughout the year so that we can encourage them so that they can become a big ally for the district. I mean, give me a chance. Put me 100 parents, 200 parents in a room. I don't care. I give them presentations to audiences as big as 400 people all over California, all over the United States. And every time that I do a presentation with this very interesting topics, the parents get very, very excited, and they go home taking very, very important tools that if they implement it, it will benefit the district overall.
Board members, do you have questions? Mr. Calderon said no.
Not so much a question, but more of a comment in general. I think, number one, it's an excellent idea. I think it's something that for a long time this district has talked about in getting parent involvement. We've talked about the attendance issues. We've talked about our at-risk children. And time again, we go back to, what are we doing for our families? And there's a bigger demand on our schools, on every employee in a school when it comes to taking care of our kids. I know teachers sort of double up as counselors and as parents sometimes, and administrators see a lot of these children and these families that really go through tough times, and they rely on the school as sort of the one source where, like, the sort of one stop where they can get a lot of services. I think it'd be a wonderful addition to this district to really fully involve our parents by providing something for them as well. So I think it's a great idea. I think some parents tend to feel isolated. I was in a school site for many years and had the opportunity to always try to go and find other parents and bring in other parents to be involved. And I'd approach parents and they'd say, no, and I don't speak English, or I don't know that I can understand the information that's put in front of me. And I think they sort of tend to feel isolated in terms of what they can actually do within a district. And really the empowerment that it gives children when their parents are involved and their parents understand that that the school is there for them, and the kids can certainly take advantage of that. When I was growing up, we were certainly that family that my mom took advantage of every opportunity. And as a kid, I died when I saw my mom walking into the school, and I thought, please go away. But she took advantage of everything that was there. I went to Maine's when I was little, and she just went to everything. She went to every meeting. She went to every English class, and she learned English. So when we were home, and she was teaching us, she was trying to help us with homework, she was learning it simultaneously with us. So I know she bonded a lot with the folks that were there when we were growing up. So, you know, I sort of feel like I'm one of these kids, or we were these kids myself, my brothers and sisters, whose parents took advantage of what was available, because the schools, the district, the staff really made our parents feel welcome and had opportunities. Thanks.
Ms. Annie Yurick?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Padilla.
Annie Yurick, kindergarten teacher at Blanchard School for the past 20 plus years. For the past, I'm going to say, 10, 15 years, Blanche Charles, whether there's monies involved or available or not, Blanche Charles kinder teachers have always hosted a pre-kinder academy. It might be 2 weeks, 1 week, depending on the teachers that volunteer. Within this academy that we have during the summer, for the past, I wouldn't say 15 years, before Mrs. Gina Sanchez was still there, we offered and still offer parent training. We offer 4 hours of parent training, and it makes a difference. Compare what they call the students, which parents do not go to the pre-kinder academy parent training. The students are, I want to say, more, what do you call, more at ease at school. The parents are, more aware of the academic expectations of the students. So I really, really, really support any parent training that you have, parent involvement, and not just start at the junior high or upper elementary grades. I think it needs to start before first grade in kinder. And like I said, Blanche Charles has been an advocate, and I know Ms. Armendariz, we've always offered the pre-kinder, and we teachers volunteer, and we do offer parent trainings, and the parents are introduced to the academic expectations of the incoming kinder students. There's hardly any crying or runners during the first week of those students that attend the pre-kinder academy, and the parents are more aware of what we expect. So it does help. Parent trainings do help.
Okay. Thank you. So, there is a second part, but since it wasn't listed on under the discussion items, I will not address it. But there is another component to it. So I'll leave that for the next board meeting. And seeing that we have no further discussion, I would like to, if my colleagues are in agreement, that we give direction for it this to be placed as an action item for the next agenda. Are you comfortable with that, board members?
An action item to implement a program?
Well, to move forward and put together something in terms of a district committee of people.
Oh, I see. Yes.
And if it's put together within time of the next board meeting, if it can be placed as an action item.
Are we going to be receiving any sort of help from ICOE? Are we going to, did we have a parent program before?
That's the presentation that Mr. Padilla brought up. We're not looking at towards ICOE, we're looking within. I think that's, please go to the podium.
ICOE asked us for help to develop a program, because Calexico has always had a group of people that are very knowledgeable and very advocate for it. There was a time when the district brought PK, and PK served some services for some parents, but the needs of the more important needs that we have in our district were not addressed. So ICOE decided that they wanted to have our own local program. So he invited Rosa Lopez, myself, and others from El Centro and other places. And at the end, Rosa Lopez, myself, and this other teacher from El Centro, can't remember his name, were the last ones to stand. And we developed this program that directs students to the university. And it has the component, the 7 weeks is a component that we use here for the parent project. But the importance of making it our program, you know, like Ms. Urich was saying, you know, when you address your parents, when we train our teachers to address their parents, students, it's much more powerful than having anybody coming from the outside. You know, bringing people from the outside that are not there the whole year to continue that connection with parents, with children, and everything will make it less powerful. The powerful thing is that, and we do have the people to develop a program of prevention and intervention in the elementary. We have the people to continue in the higher grades all the way to high school. And there's a group of people that would be very interested in sitting in a committee and developing a program, our program, where we can have several well-renowned presenters and even trainers to train other teachers that would be interested in delivering those to our parents. That is the beauty and the power. That was the beauty and the power of our parenting project at Willie Moreno. When we were there, we saw elementary as a prevention, and we always wanted to be part of it, but it was never possible. There was never that link for whatever reason, which is not for any discussion. The thing is that if we have all that connection, elementary, prevention, and teaching, you know, all these skills that the kids need when they become adolescents, and then when they become adolescents, how to deal with the troubles of an adolescent, and then later on, how to pursue a higher education career, you know, there's a link to it, and it begins in elementary. And if we, our teachers, are able to have that connection with our parents, that's the power of it. And ICOE, well, yes, you know, maybe we can have some assistance, but it would be better if it's just money. But the people that that will have to implement it is us, because we are the ones who are connected with the parents.
The reason that I was asking is because in 2005, ICOE had a program called Padres Promotores de la Educación, Parents Promoters of Education.
Yeah.
So it was a countywide program. And after I left ICOE, it kept running for a couple more years, and I don't know what happened, but it was exactly what you're talking about. You meet with the parents, educate parents. Mm-hmm. So that's what I was asking.
Yeah, and we developed the one that is called Pulse, and we went, and but like I say, I was a presenter for Pulse. I would go to Holtville and present, and it was like, oh yeah, this is wonderful and stuff, but then I didn't see them anymore. And when you have your own presenters here in Calexico, they see them there the whole year, how it's working. And that was the beauty of about our project in William Moreno, because the whole staff was involved. So when the kids were going through William Moreno, it was 3 years, and you could see the difference in terms of discipline, attendance, and most important for the district at that time, which was the most important thing, was the CST scores. William Moreno was one of three schools in California that got monetary compensation from the state because of their CST scores. So all of our teachers that were in William Moreno received a $5,000 check because of our success in the CST scores. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Padilla. And we'll adjourn at 7:44.